you know, I think it was a huge game changer. I mean, this is a disease where there aren't a huge number of available treatments, particularly systemic treatments. The landscape included the somatostatin analog, which has been around for many years. It included everolimus, Afinitor, which tends to be more of a disease stabilizer than something that actually shrinks tumors. That's mostly the extent of it as far as systemic treatment. So to have this new treatment available, it's, I think, a huge deal, because a lot of patients were flying to Europe, flying to South America, and it was very difficult. As I said earlier, it's for sure in the large majority of patients, it should come after somatostatin analog, but whether it's second line, third line, fourth line, or fifth line really depends on the particular circumstance, what else is available, and what your doctor prefers. For many patients, it should be, will and should be second line, but we're lacking data. We have no studies comparing two active treatments in patients who progress. Not really. I mean, trying to figure out the best way of sequencing treatments is quite challenging. There is a study taking place now comparing a slightly different radiolabeled somatostatin analog called Lutetium dotatoc to everolimus in patients with non-functioning gastroenteropancreatic neuroendocrine tumors. So that will be an interesting study. There's no good data on how best to sequence treatments.
Mm-hmm. You think as kind of a case-by-case basis?
Correct. I mean, generally you want to go with your more effective, less toxic treatments earlier rather than later, but, you know, you can make good arguments either way. That goes back to what I was just saying earlier, that there's some data that, at least as far as tumor shrinkage, large tumors may not do as well. And therefore, some people say, well, if you can remove the larger tumors, then maybe PRRT will work better. I would say that's fairly controversial. But, you know, if you can remove large tumors and remove a large amount of disease without too much morbidity, it might be a good thing. But, you know, the whole concept of surgical debulking is sort of fraught with controversy, because there's certainly no high level evidence. There's no randomized data. So you're relying a lot on impressions and instinct, and it makes it very difficult to figure that out. It's usually an independent question. I mean, there are cases where surgery is just not possible unless tumors shrink, and you may want to consider PRRT before surgery. Of course, the rate of tumor shrinkage, as I discussed earlier, is not huge. It's probably higher for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors versus small bowel. So there's not too many circumstances where we would give so-called neoadjuvant PRRT, but I mean, I guess it certainly could be considered under particular circumstances. You know, there's different types of radiation. Lutetium is a so-called a beta radiation emitter. There is a different type of particle radiation called alpha radiation, which delivers a much higher energy over a much shorter range. Mm-hmm. So it's basically using different isotopes like lead or actinium. Theoretically, it sounds very exciting, potentially a way of delivering radiation more safely because of less, you know, scatter of the radiation outside of the area of the tumor. And I would, you know, say stay tuned. There's going to be, I think, some very exciting data in the near future, hopefully on early data with alpha radiation. So there are several institutions that are working on this. Yeah, so, you know, I didn't mention alpha emitters before. I mean, that still is PRRT if you're using the alpha emitters as, you know, combining them with a radio, you know, with a somatostatin analog, for example, or any other peptide that targets a peptide receptor. drug development is slow, and you start with early phase studies, phase one studies, which look at tolerability. You move on to phase two studies, which look at efficacy. Then randomized studies, which compare two drugs. So I'd say it's going to be a long time before we, you know, if alpha therapy is developed, it's going to be a long time before we see randomized studies comparing it to the current beta-emitting lutetium. Will it replace it at some point? You know, perhaps. I hope that we make progress and we have better and safer drugs. I'm vaguely aware of it. I think they're using dosimetry to try to maximize the number of treatments, and I guess it's up to 12. I mean, 12 sounds like a huge number if each is 200 millicuries, which is what we're giving right now. I mean, the bottom line is that a lot of people can tolerate more than four. Some people can't tolerate four. Whether dosimetry is really the way to establish how much patients can tolerate, I think, is quite controversial, because mostly dosimetry is looking at kidney exposure, and a lot of people, the kidney exposure is just not a main issue. Whereas there's an advantage to try to stack up as much PRRT early on is debatable. You know, there is risk that it would leave patients, for example, with low blood counts, increased risk of long-term bone marrow damage, if not other problems. So we don't know. It's going to be really challenging to design trials that compare different ways of administering PRRT. Mm-hmm. You know, if we're talking about PRRT as a whole, I'd say the alpha-emitting PRRT is probably the most exciting to me because it's a completely novel type of radiation. But, you know, there are other approaches. There's a drug that's a somatostatin receptor antagonist that has an even stronger affinity to the somatostatin receptor that's being developed. There's combination treatments. But you know, for combination, you really want to make sure that you're talking about synergy, that that the combined treatments are better than just the additive effects of the two drugs. So combination, for example, with PARP inhibitors that inhibit DNA damage repair, those are pretty interesting.